The Nurse by Kristian Corfixen. Read by Colin Mace for Saga Egmont. Foreword. I am not a nurse, nor was I at any point present when Christina Eistrup Hansen worked at Nykøbing Falster Hospital. Nonetheless, I have taken the liberty of describing in detail a protracted series of events that occurred during her years at the hospital. I have done so based on over 3,000 pages of documentation concerning the murder case against the nurse. This documentary evidence consists primarily of materials that have been revealed or otherwise made available to me upon application in my professional capacity as a journalist. Patients, medical charts, coroner's reports, forensic analyses, text messages and mail correspondence, expert reports, court transcripts, medical lists, screen printouts from the hospital's IT systems, photographs, witness statements, and police reports. This material, at least the bulk of it, has not previously been available to individuals other than the police, the legal courts, and the parties to the case. In my endeavour to describe what happened in Nykøbing Falster, the police interview reports have been particularly significant. I was granted access to over 100 witness statements from the hospital staff, who helped to solve the puzzle underlying the legal proceedings against Christina Eistrup Hansen. More than 70 people testified in a court of law. The narrative in this book is based on their explanations as well as the interviews with over 50 persons connected to the case. The witnesses who contributed to the narrative are nurses, doctors, experts, lawyers, employees of the police forces, as well as family members and acquaintances of the principal actors in the case, and the next of kin of the victims. Not least of these is Christina Eistrup Hansen, whom I visited in prison on several occasions. I have also had detailed conversations with the key witness in the case, the nurse, Pernilla Kurtzman Larsen, whose testimony was the reason that the police began to investigate the suspicious deaths at Nykøbing Falster Hospital in the first place. Her testimony had a particular significance for the ultimate conviction of her colleague on multiple charges of attempted murder. Almost without exception, all the nurses from Nykøbing Falster Hospital whom I contacted asked me from the outset, and with obvious reluctance, "From whose side do you intend to describe the case?" Every time I answered, "From both sides." Because there are two sides, two camps, if you will. The first are those who, to this day, believe that Christina Eistrup Hansen is innocent and has been unlawfully convicted by two courts of law. They are convinced that the nurse is a victim of gossip at a provincial hospital. The other camp comprises those people who do not doubt that the nurse took the lives of patients on her shifts, perhaps even more patients than the four deaths for which she is currently serving a prison sentence. It is important to emphasize that neither Christina Eistrup Hansen nor Pernilla Kurtzman Larsen, nor anyone else for that matter, had any influence on the way I have chosen to describe or highlight the incidents appearing in this audiobook. And no one has been offered any payment nor a right to edit what I have written if they agreed to talk to me. In other words, this book is the product of the standard methods of professional journalism. As far as possible, I have tried to fact and cross-check the information presented to me by my sources. If I came across something contradictory or incompatible with other information in documents or similar materials, such testimony has been admitted, if it is not relevant to the case. In this audiobook, I have also drawn attention to any instances where a situation appears to strain the truth. Similarly, I have drawn the listener's attention to any testimony which the police have not been able to confirm or deny, despite their extensive investigations and endeavours to do so. That said, I know there will be listeners of this audiobook who will form a different view of one or several things that are described. Many people have an opinion about the nurse case, as it was dubbed by the media. Not even a conviction in the Magistrates' Court and the High Court in Nykøbing Falster has been able to alter the fact that this case is steeped in numerous home-baked theories. And during my journalistic investigation, I encountered many people who have based their understanding of the case on a completely skewed or distorted conception of what this is in fact about. Perhaps this is because they have only read the headlines, or two or three of the thousands of articles written about it, and have joined the discussion on this limited basis. Or perhaps they heard something from someone who knows someone who once knew someone. I hope that this audiobook can contribute to a coherent, sober, and more comprehensive report on one of the most notorious murder cases in Danish criminal history. The nurse case has had significant and wide-ranging consequences, which are not limited to the four patients for whose deaths Christina Eistrup Hansen was found guilty on charges of attempted murder. There are colleagues at Nykøbing Falster Hospital who are still struggling to come to terms with feelings of guilt for not having acted on their suspicions earlier. There are the loved ones of the patients who were unwittingly drawn into a murder case whilst lying defenceless in beds within an institutional healthcare system to which we ordinarily entrust our health, safety, and welfare. There are two parents who, in the many years to come, must visit their daughter in a prison. And there is an 11-year-old girl who has lost her mother's presence in her daily life. The nurse case is tragic in every way you look at it, even more so because it harmed others for so long before anyone reacted. I hope that this audiobook can help to ensure that we do not forget this case, so that we may learn from it. Kristian Corfixen, Copenhagen, January 2019. Chapter 1. Operations Control Center received the call at 4 minutes to midnight. A female doctor from Nykøbing Falster Hospital was on the line reporting a death that on her initial assessment could not be explained. The call was entirely standard procedure. According to Danish law, a doctor must always inform the authorities when one of their patients suddenly dies without any immediate and plausible explanation apparent from the patient's medical chart. This was the case with Anna Hersko, the patient whom the doctor had declared dead a little over 2 hours ago, as she said on the phone. The officer on duty noted the date, 4th of March 2012, as well as the facts that the doctor listed. Anna Hersko, 72 years old, address, Falkevej 78 in Ilstrup, divorced, last observed conscious today between 7 a.m. and 9:39 a.m. Thereafter put on a respirator after a cardiac arrest. Passed away this evening. His brother Kenny is the next of kin. Shortly afterwards, a patrol car with two officers drove into the night in the direction of the northern outskirts of the town of Nykøbing Falster. At 1:20 a.m. they reported their arrival at the ICU. The police officers found a nurse and a doctor able to inform them who had taken care of the patient during the day and evening, and they jotted down a few names and telephone numbers in a notebook before they were shown to the hospital room where Arne was still lying in his bed. Potentially the room could be a crime scene, but when they opened the door, it was clear that it had not remained untouched. The deceased lay on his back in his blue jeans and a checked cardigan with black arms, his own clothing, so the patient would not be in a hospital gown when his family said their final goodbyes. The tubing to which he had been attached had been removed. The corpse had been prepared, because once the now deceased was confirmed dead, it was not known that the police should be notified, the officers later noted in their report. Then the police made their way to Medical Ward M130, as they were told that this was the department where Anna had been hospitalised in the preceding days. It was here that he was found, lifeless in his bed that morning. The staff had tried to resuscitate him with a heart massage before he was transferred to the ICU. The nurses who had been on duty at that time had long since gone home. Now other nurses, including Ida and the SOSU assistant Nina, were on duty on M130 whilst the patients slept. It was the nurses' second night shift in a row, and when the two colleagues had clocked in at 11 p.m, they were surprised to learn that the elderly man in room 134 had suddenly stopped breathing. On the morning of the previous day, both nurses had checked in on Anna before leaving him and the other patients in the care of the day shift team, whilst they went home to get some sleep. Ida had talked to Anna. Ever since he had been admitted, it had been difficult to coax him to eat anything, but that morning Arne had woken up early and asked for a protein ice cream of his own accord. He had never done this before. "He's perking up," Ida had thought as she left his room. The frail man had even been a little cheeky with her. She took this as a healthy sign. Arne was beginning to feel better. The same morning, Nina had waved at Arne as he shuffled out of his room on the way to the toilet across the corridor. Now, Arne was dead. Their colleagues informed the night shift when they clocked in again that evening and were briefed about the status of the various patients in the rooms. It was hard to understand how this could have happened. Ida and Nina were not aware that the death had been reported to the police in the interim, and it was an unpleasant surprise to have the two officers come through the door of M130. The officers were friendly, but it was still disconcerting when they immediately started asking questions about the patient in room 134. Nina told the police that she had waved to him in the corridor, that she'd had the impression that Arne was feeling better. Ida told them about Arne asking for a protein ice cream, and that she felt he was regaining his appetite. "The deceased, normally depressed, appeared to be perking up," one of the officers noted. The police were done for the evening. Within an hour of their arrival at the hospital, they were back in their patrol car in the parking lot. The case did not appear to require any further investigation that could not wait till the following morning. Once the police had left, Ida broke down in tears, and then she confided in Nina. She told her something that had been upsetting her for quite some time. There were so many patients who had suddenly taken a turn for the worse on M130. Of course, she knew that they were ill. This was why they had been hospitalized after all. But their condition having suddenly deteriorated seemed strange to Ida. As with Arne, the turn often coincided with a change of shift. And for some strange reason, it was one of their colleagues in particular who always happened to be nearby. And she was the one who found the lifeless patients in their beds and sounded the alarm. Ida and Nina went to the office to check the so-called Morsbo, a soft-covered notebook which looked like a standard school notebook, wherein the staff noted the names of the patients who died on their ward. In the margins of the lined pages, opposite the name of each patient, was a signature. Typically, this signature was entered into the book by one of the nurses or their assistants who had prepared the deceased, as it was called, for the relatives and bereaved when they came to take final leave of their loved one. Ida and Nina counted the mors, or deaths, noted in the book. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Not every patient who went into cardiac arrest on M130 was named in the morsbo. Many of them were transferred to other departments when their condition deteriorated, like Arne, who was transferred to the ICU, for instance. But those patients who had actually died on medical ward M130 were noted in these pages. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Ida and Nina counted how many times the same name appeared. 11, 12, 13. It was clear that it was her signature in most cases. 14, 15. This was even though she was a nurse. Usually, the SOSU assistants prepared the deceased, especially on the day shifts when the nurses were terribly busy with all kinds of other duties. 16, 17, 18, 19. This is utterly horrific, Ida thought. 20, 21, 22, 22. It was their colleague, the nurse Christina, who had signed her name next to 22 of the patients who had been confirmed dead on ward M130 over the last 6 months or so. There was no other staff member in their department who had registered so many deaths. No other name came anywhere close to 22 cases, and Christina wasn't even employed full-time at the hospital. That night, Ida finally said it out loud to another person. She said it to Nina. She was afraid that Christina was intentionally killing the patients. Chapter 2. The provincial hospital rises above the other buildings on the northern outskirts of New Cobing Falster, about a quarter of an hour's walk from where the town's main pedestrian street ends. The parking lot and red brick facade of the hospital is situated amongst residential buildings. Out here, you won't get stuck in a queue at the roundabout, unless you happen to be on the road when there is a change of shift. Back in the 1950s, when the hospital was established on Falster Island, the land offered real estate plots right on the water's edge. Ever since, the white-framed windows of the six-storey hospital building has boasted a shorefront view over Gullbolsund. Nykøbing Falster Hospital may be small, but as anyone who has been hospitalised or visited or simply enjoyed a lunch in the canteen on the third floor will attest, it does have a magnificent view. If you are one of the patients lucky enough to be stationed on the right-hand side of the corridor in the tall buildings, you will have a view of the Sound from your bed when the backrest is in the upright position. Should you have someone open your sea-facing window, you can feel the wind that picks up over the sea, just on the other side of the asphalt road. From here, you can also see the shores of Lolland Island, which lies on the opposite side of the fairway, green and so close that only a thick fog can hide it from the naked eye. Patients arriving from Lolland are transported over the bridges from Moon and the southernmost corners of Sealand. Approximately 26,000 times a year, a person living on Falster or one of the surrounding islands in the region has a condition that requires hospitalisation. For Arne Hersko, this was the case on the 17th of February 2012. His younger brother Kenny was the one who brought him in. That day, Arne must have heard Kenny's beige Peugeot when it turned onto his driveway. It was just after lunchtime, and Kenny sat in his car for a moment, listening to the live radio coverage of Friday's football match. He just wanted to catch the final commentary before braving the February cold, clicking open the door and trudging over the lawn to visit his brother. But when he switched off the engine, he heard Arne calling for help from inside the house. Kenny found his brother on the bathroom floor, dazed and confused. Arne had slipped and fallen. He was unable to get up and could not explain how long he had been lying on the floor. His body was cold. Kenny immediately dialed 112. The Falck ambulance team were quick to respond, and Kenny's Peugeot was still warm when he put the key in the ignition and set off after the sirens, heading westwards on the road that meandered through the meadows of Falster. That day, when the ambulance drove off with Arne, no one imagined that he would never return to the little house behind the hedge on Falkevej. Arne arrived at the hospital in the afternoon. Weighing only 61 kilos, the patient did little more than dent the white covering of the mattress when he was placed on a bed in the ICU. Arne was critically underweight, emaciated, the doctor noted in the patient's chart. It was also noted by the staff that Arne was dehydrated and his blood pressure was low. His white blood cell count indicated that he could have a lung infection. He was given antibiotics 3 times daily to bring down his high white blood cell count. Apart from this, nutrition therapy was the prescribed treatment typed into Arne's medical chart. As the staff subsequently explained to Arne's 3 siblings, it was imperative that the patient put some meat on his bones, and the nurses were instructed to give him plenty of fluids. In fact, Arne already had a habit of taking in a fair amount of fluids, but not the kind that could be administered via a drip by his hospital bed. Arne had always had a fondness for beer. He stashed some in the bicycle basket fastened to the handlebars of his 3-wheeled scooter whenever he drove the short distance to Marienlyst, and popped in at Butcher's Sko to buy TV dinners, which he could warm up in the oven when he got back home. In the summertime, the green bottles opened at his side, Arne liked to chill out by Silstrup Beach. He always drank Carlsberg from the bottle, recalled the owner of the kiosk near the beach, where Arne spent hours on end, letting the sun warm his red blonde hair. To this day, the kiosk owner still misses her client. He never started talking nonsense, no matter how many beers he drank, and he drank a lot of them. Many people remember Arne on account of the green bottles, but if you ask his sister Birde whether Arne was an alcoholic, her answer is an emphatic no. Never, she says. He enjoyed life. But the patient's body was worn, especially on account of the alcohol, which had left its mark on Arne's liver function. This was clear from the first tests done at Nykøbing Falster Hospital. Apart from the alcohol, cigarettes had been detrimental to his health. Arne had told a doctor that from the age of 15, he'd probably smoked 30 or 40 a day, which was duly noted in the patient's medical chart. And then there was the cough. A cough that had prompted his neighbours across the road on Falkevej to remark over their evening coffee, "Aha, Anna's home." Amongst the wood-panelled summer houses and freshly painted homes on the street, Anna lived on the corner, where some of the neighbourhood's loftiest trees were planted. His house had originally been a shed, but a concrete annex had been built onto it, making room for a fire burner, which constantly pumped black smoke up over the trees from the little chimney on his roof as soon as the weather turned. From the front door, it was only a couple of hundred metres to the beach, but Anna spent most of his time indoors, unless he was out and about with his bicycle basket, that is. It was on these occasions that the neighbours would catch a glimpse of him, when he was in the driveway, either on his way out or just returned home. Once you had got to know him properly, for people new to the neighbourhood, a few years might pass before the opportunity arose, you soon realised that this guy who lived alone was an amiable fellow who liked a good chat. And he had strong opinions about things. For instance, it was typical for Anna to get worked up when he talked about retirement homes and the way that society treated the elderly. More than a few members of his family had heard his views on drugs, or narcotics, as Anna dismissively labelled the substances his entire life. He could never understand why any human being would want to get mixed up with them. But he spoke fondly of his younger years and the times when, as a teenager, he had sailed around the world in container ships, with the Maersk logo painted on the sides. Or of his childhood, growing up with his siblings in the brown-bricked pub neighbourhood in the Nørrebro quarter of Copenhagen. Or about the days when Arne, before he became a street cleaner, used to sell flowers and vegetables in the Grøntsagsbutikken marketplace. Or the smoker's pub adjacent to the square, where he met his future wife. Arne's mood was as cheerful as a pub in the final hours before closing time. He loved to party, and he had been known to break into song, sea shanties and such like, and he generally looked like someone who knew how to have a good time. Even when one of his brothers popped in unannounced to find Anna home alone, enjoying a couple of the butcher's open sandwiches, his favourite meal. But it was not always this way. In recent times, Anna had been feeling incredibly sad. It is said that one of the worst things that can happen to a person is the loss of their child, and Anna had experienced this firsthand. A few months before he fell in the bathroom, he had received the news that Jimmy, his only son, was dead. The loss of Jimmy was the tragedy of his life. It left a gaping hole in his pensioner's existence and a lump in his throat that Anna just could not wash down, no matter how many beers he drank. In the end, he made no attempt to hide from his siblings that he had pretty much given up on life. He was tired of being alone, he said, and no matter how much firewood his two brothers brought to his stone-cold house, Anna had difficulty finding good things to warm his heart. He didn't even feel like warming up his TV dinners. Beer was the only thing that would go down his throat. His cheerful mood drowned, and Anna's siblings became worried about him. This is another reason why the family was relieved when he was admitted to the hospital, where he would be surrounded by trained staff who could take over his care. When Anna arrived, he was pale and his body was shaking. He was so terribly cold, as he told the nurses again and again, but soon it was clear that his condition was not life-threatening. "I believe that the main problem is that the patient has not eaten for a month," the chief physician noted in Anna's medical chart after he had been in the ICU for 3 days. On day 4, his condition was no longer critical and Anna was moved to ward M130. Here, the staff would make sure that he gained weight. The medical ward M130 treats some of Nykøbing Falster Hospital's most seriously ill patients. The people in these rooms suffer primarily from critical gastrointestinal issues. There are several cancer patients amongst them. Alcoholics and other addicts are transferred to M130. People who have a weak liver, people in rehabilitation, people who, as a rule, are battling other challenges in their lives, in addition to the medical diagnoses that they are given upon hospitalisation. The patients on M130 are the tough customers, as the nurses refer to them. It is not unusual for a tough customer to return for a second or a tenth time, and many of them are familiar faces when they are wheeled into a room. And they usually stay longer than those who are resident in the hospital's other wings. It is not uncommon for a patient on M130 to be hospitalised for several weeks at a time. M130 has two corridors, Corridor 30 and Corridor 50, which are at right angles to one another and have rooms leading off on both sides. Anna was allocated a room on corridor 30, directly opposite the toilets. In the beginning, the new patient made a quiet impression on the staff. He seemed to be the kind of person who preferred to sleep, with neither the wish nor the strength for much else. But as the days passed, many of the staff noticed that Anna began to cheer up. More animation and expression in the patient's face, talking more spontaneously, was written in his medical chart, 4 days after his arrival at the hospital. On the same day, a nurse from M130 noted, "Sat up in bed on his own accord and eats what is put in front of him." The cough was still there. Anna was often dizzy, and he was still hooked up to an oxygen tube and fed via a drip. But now it was easier to get him to eat solid food, in addition to what he received intravenously. His appetite is returning and he is eating more. Asked for food today himself, the staff recorded the day after. The SOSU assistant, Louise, noted that Anna became more responsive as he gradually started to gain a little weight. The first time she met the patient in room 134, he told her about Jimmy's death and declared that he was not sure he wanted to live anymore. When doctors and nurses came in to check on Anna, he often told them about his tragedy, and several people thereafter concluded in his medical records that the patient was depressed. But then one day, Anna told Louise that he was starting to look forward to going home again. At that time, he had been hospitalised for almost 2 weeks, and the staff on the ward had noticed that something was starting to change in his mood. He seemed more positive in general. He talked more. He was awake more often. His physical condition had improved to such a degree that the staff started making plans for his discharge. In his medical chart on Thursday the 1st of March 2012, 13 days after Anna had been admitted, a nurse noted, "The patient is expected to be released at the beginning of next week." Kenny came to visit Anna on Corridor 30 on the Friday, and whatever treatment his brother was receiving, it appeared to be working. Anna was still a bit disoriented and confused, but he had gained weight. His niece, Mary Louise, noted that Uncle Anna was feeling better when she came to visit him. He was cheerful, smiling, and he even made jokes and told her a pirate's tale. His sister, Birda, and his elder brother, Vaughn, visited on the Saturday, which was Anna's 16th day at the hospital. Sitting by his bedside, they told him that his house on Falkovay was waiting for him to be discharged. His sister-in-law had washed his bedding and curtains and everything. It was all set and ready for him. But Anna was still too thin. A nurse out on the corridor advised Bertha that it would probably be best if her younger brother was placed in a home where someone could ensure that he got enough to eat. Perhaps a retirement home or some other kind of care institution would be appropriate. It need not be for more than a few days. Vaughn smiled from his perch on the other side of the bed when Bertha presented this option to Anna. They both knew how their brother would react, clearly remembering all the times he had fumed that retirement homes in Denmark were not places fit to send folks. "If only I were on the fifth floor, then I could jump out of the window." Birda can't help but smile when she recalls Anna's quip. It was so typical of him to make a remark like that. The day after Birda and Vaughn's visit, just after 9 a.m, the staff on M130 prepared for their Sunday morning coffee break. 2 hours earlier, there had been a change of shift. The night shift nurses, Ida and Nina, had gone home, and the SOSU assistant, Louise, had arrived with the day shift nurses, Peter and Christina. One of the first things Louise had done was bring Anna a fat slice of traditional baked beer loaf with cream, and she promised to help him bathe later that day. Then she left him in peace to eat his food. When she came back a quarter of an hour later, he was sitting there with his empty plate on his lap, and he asked, "Happy now?" He had eaten all of it. He smiled at her. "He's definitely starting to cheer up," she thought. The day shift nurses had checked the medical charts when they arrived on the ward at 7 a.m, and then went about their morning rounds. Christina was responsible for administering the prescribed medication to the patients, and she had been down the corridor with their daily dosages. Meanwhile, Peter had been in to check on Anna, for whom he had laid out a fresh towel and clean clothing. He measured Anna's stat values, temperature, blood pressure, breathing, pulse, and oxygen levels in the patient's blood. He found nothing noteworthy, and no changes from what the night shift staff had reported during handover that morning. Peter was the first one to finish his rounds, So, when 9 o'clock came around, he started to brew some coffee and get things ready for the break in the staff room. They always had breakfast with the staff from Corridor 50 once the routine tasks had been completed, and his colleagues were slowly starting to arrive. It appeared to be a quiet shift. There were no acute patients. But then his beeper sounded. In one of the rooms, someone had pulled twice on the cord to initiate the cardiac arrest alarm procedure. Peter, Louise, and the others ran down Corridor 30, took a sharp left, and entered room 134. Their colleague Christina was sat with her back to the entrance, on the edge of the first of the room's two beds. She had ripped open Anna's shirt and was performing a heart massage. Louise moved the bed away from the wall so that they could have unhindered access to the patient, and Christina kept pumping Anna's chest. Peter prepared the medication and a syringe. A SOSU assistant from Corridor 50 applied a mask to supply the patient with extra oxygen. A third nurse watched from the sidelines. It was the first time she had experienced a real-life attempt to revive a patient. She was newly qualified and appointed to the ward, and Christina had encouraged her to stay and observe what happened. It was useful to learn how the alarm procedure was carried out, the more experienced nurse said. The porters and the doctors arrived without delay. Christina stepped into the background but maintained an overview of the situation. She recited the patient's name, his stats, and the reason for his hospitalization. She said that she'd found him lifeless in his bed and had initiated resuscitation proceedings. When an entire team of professional staff focused their combined skills on the task of reviving the bodily functions of a human being, even an experienced nurse can become flustered. Peter, for instance, seemed nervous, whilst Christina commandeered his actions. His hands were shaking, and he accidentally knocked a blood pressure device onto the floor. It is in these situations that Christina stood out from the crowd. She was not afraid to take charge where others might falter. Christina came into her own during a cardiac arrest procedure, and she was a valued member of the team. The team managed to get the patient's heart beating again. Anna was transferred to the ICU immediately, the same ward he had been transferred from 12 days earlier. His now battered ribcage, with 11 broken ribs, was moving slightly. He was breathing, but he required help from a respirator to do so, and the staff had difficulty surmising what could have caused the sudden change in his condition. Why had Anna's bodily functions failed? Had it not been recorded in his medical chart that the patient was improving? The chief physician on duty lifted the patient's eyelid and tried to determine if she could find an explanation. The pupils were contracted to small dots, she noted. This surprised her. Could the patient have received too much morphine? The intensive care staff at New Cobing Falster Hospital had often found that opioids and benzodiazepines appeared in the bloodstream of those patients who were brought lifeless to their ward from M130. There are opioids in morphine. Benzodiazepines are found in, amongst other things, stesolid. But often the ICU staff discovered that neither morphine nor stesolid had been prescribed and recorded in the patient's medical charts entered into the electronic record system, which the nurses used to register a prescription whenever they gave the patients their medication, as per doctor's orders. The ICU staff were therefore wary of cases transferred from M130. It was common knowledge that M130 was a busy ward, and that this certainly increased the risk of error. It was common knowledge that many drug addicts were admitted to the ward, and even though it was extremely rare, patients had been known to bring drugs from home, a circumstance which was hard for the staff to monitor. Nonetheless, it often seemed as if the error could be ascribed to the nurses on the ward. For example, mistakes could occur when they tried to detoxify a drug addict. There was the case of a patient who, in such a detoxification attempt, had received an overdose of chlordiazepoxide, a drug used to dull alcohol withdrawal symptoms. Usually, a nurse will administer a dosage between 50 and 200 milligrams, which is distributed over a period of a few hours. But in this case, the patient had been given 2 grams, which was a gross medication error. With such a high concentration of chlordiazepoxide in the patient's bloodstream, it was not surprising that he suffered cardiac arrest as a result and had to be transferred to the ICU. On several other occasions, a similar error in medication had occurred concerning morphine. The general rule in Danish hospitals is that the nurse on duty is responsible for administering the medication prescribed by a doctor. The prescription is confirmed once it is entered into the medical chart. If morphine is prescribed, the doctor will add the initials IV if it is to be given intravenously, i.e. administered directly into the bloodstream rather than in pill form. Medication is stored in the supply rooms on the individual wards. These depots are locked, and the doctors have no business being there. This room is the nurse's domain. Nykøbing Falster Hospital follows this general rule. In the supply rooms, the nurses take the ampoules from the shelves, break them open, and draw the prescribed dosage into a syringe. The surplus medicine is flushed down the sink. The broken ampoule is thrown into a waste bin. Finally, the nurse enters the prescription administered to the patient into the hospital's electronic medication record system once they have been into the patient's room and injected the dosage. A nurse always records when a patient has received medication. Indeed, this is one of the first things you learn when you train to become a nurse. Neither Arne's medical chart nor the electronic medication record contained any notation that he had been prescribed morphine. But an anaesthetist gave Arne an antidote after she noted the state of his pupils. As a result, his body immediately responded in a way that indicated a productive chemical reaction. The patient's blood pressure rose and his pulse increased. It appeared that Arne found it easier to breathe. His pupils responded. They became bigger and began to react to light. The staff ordered a urine test. The test showed morphine opioids, as well as traces of benzodiazepines in his blood, which could indicate that Arne had also been given stesolid. The staff were perplexed. The doctors checked his medical chart and the electronic medication record several times to be sure that they had not missed anything, but the answer was in the negative. Neither morphine nor stesolid, nor any other opioids or benzodiazepines had been prescribed, noted, or mentioned in the patient's medical records. The doctors from intensive care tried to clarify what could have happened. The first possible explanation was that the staff in M130 had inadvertently given Arne the medication, which in fact was intended for his roommate. If so, it might explain why Arne was observed alive no more than 15 minutes before the patient was found in cardiac arrest, as his medical records noted. But as a doctor, added in Arne's medical chart at 1 p.m., contacted the ward nurses, who report that the roommate of the patient has not been prescribed any medication. 2.5 hours later, the mystery had still not been explained. It cannot be ruled out that the patient has taken the incorrect medication. There is no explanation for why opioids and benzodiazepines were found in the patient's urine in the drug test, wrote a new doctor, who had taken over the investigative task. Arne's cardiac arrest had put him in a coma. His brain had been damaged from lack of oxygen for a prolonged period, and after a CT scan and a series of other tests, his fate was clear. Arne would never regain consciousness. The hospital informed his brother Kenny, who promised to tell the rest of the family that nothing else could be done for their brother. They have been informed that the injury suffered by the patient is so severe that there is a failure of almost all internal organs, and that any further treatment would be without effect. The family admits that for a long time, the patient has not wished to live anymore, and that they now wish to let him pass in peace. They have agreed that we discontinue all active treatment other than palliative care, the chief physician on duty summed up in Arne's medical chart at 9 p.m., after she had spoken to Kenny and the others. That evening, his family was gathered around him when the doctors unplugged the machines which were keeping Arne alive. Kenny was there, Vaughn was there, two of Arna's nieces were there as well, and they witnessed the patient's breathing stop when the machines were switched off. On Sunday the 4th of March 2012, at 9:30 p.m, Arne Herskau was declared dead at Nykøbing Falster Hospital. The police could not find an explanation. How had the morphine and stesolid found their way into Arna's veins? 7 members of hospital staff in total were questioned in the investigation, and most of these interviews took place the day after Arne suffered his cardiac arrest. Two police officers had been dispatched to M130, where they spent some hours questioning witnesses in a conference room. The witnesses included two doctors and the nurse Peter, who had been in the M130 staff room when the alarm went off. And then there was Christina, who was the person who had activated the alarm. The police officers noted in Christina's interview report, "The witness explained that on her rounds on Sunday morning she found the door to the now deceased's room closed. As she went in to the two-man room, the deceased's roommate said, 'He's sleeping a lot today.' The witness explained that she went to the deceased's bed, where she found him lying on his back. The patient was not breathing." The officer's notes record that Christina had been team leader that weekend. This meant, according to her, that she was the one who oversaw the approval of all the medication given to the patients on the ward. Arna had been given liver medication and vitamins whilst he was hospitalised in M130. "That was all," said Christina. The witness declared that none of the medication indicated by the patient's urine test had been received on the ward. If it had, she would have known about it, the officers recorded in their interview report. The interview was over 20 minutes after it began. None of her colleagues made any suggestion to the police that they were suspicious of Christina, not even Ida or Nina, who had decided not to tell the officers anything about their counting of the cases recorded in the Mooresbaugh, nor that they suspected their colleague. M130 heard no more from the police. After a brief investigation, the authorities chose to suspend the case file on Anna's death, even though the autopsy confirmed what the doctors believed they had discovered, that there was both morphine and stesolid in Anna's bloodstream, which conflicted with the information in his medical chart. The hospital instigated an internal investigation, which was tasked with finding an explanation for the mystery. The investigation concluded that Arna must have got hold of some drugs on the ward and that he had intentionally taken an overdose. This conclusion was conveyed to his next of kin. But it made no sense. They simply did not understand. Arna had always been such a strong opponent of drugs. Chapter 3. Despite being the smallest hospital in Region Sealand, Nykøbing Falster Hospital is located in a corner of the country where people have a higher incidence and gravity of illness than the average person living in Denmark. Doctors who have experience in other institutions can attest that the first thing you notice when you start working at the provincial hospital is this. In Nykøbing Falster, you encounter a great number of patients with multiple diagnoses. There is a higher frequency of patients from socially disadvantaged circumstances, which often means that they face a series of problems other than those treatable in a hospital bed. There tends to be a higher incidence of people who exemplify the extreme end of what can happen if you wait too long before consulting a doctor. And, in this part of the country, the patients are generally heavier than average, and this kind of patient is particularly overrepresented on the island of Lolland. Here on the flat landscape of the fourth largest island of the Danish archipelago, the cheapest real estate is up for sale. In recent years, this has led to Lolland becoming a kind of depot in the south for many people who cannot afford to live elsewhere. According to a series of stories in the media, this tendency has been aided by the communes and the local government institutions in Denmark. Indeed, it has been revealed that officials and social workers of the communes of Copenhagen tend to point their clients south, to Lolland especially, when they complain that they cannot pay their rent in the capital. Lolland has become a destination for socially disadvantaged families who have essentially been deported. As one frustrated local councillor of the Danish political party, Venstre, left, formulated it a few years ago. He and his colleagues at the townhouse of Naxko discovered the notorious practice in the comparatively rich communes in and around the capital city. Since the 1990s, an extraordinarily high number of unemployed clients receiving social benefits from the Danish state have headed over the bridges to the southern islands, with the young and resource-strong families heading back the other way. As a result, the island of Lolland holds the dubious Danish record for the highest number of estates sold in bankruptcy auctions, as well as the highest record of youth unemployment. Lolan also has the greatest share of citizens on the dole. And when it comes to unhealthy lifestyles and nutrition, Lolan Commune is the front runner in the kind of statistical race that no one wants to lead. In 2017, when the Danish Health Authority published its extensive report on health, the incidence of disease and well-being in Denmark, Lolland was once again subjected to a battery of depressing figures. The greatest percentage of people who do not fulfil the official recommendations for minimum daily physical activity, for example, live on Lolland. It has the greatest number of people who seldom, if ever, have the resource of a social network. Lolland has the highest levels of obesity in Denmark, the greatest number of smokers, not to mention the number of people diagnosed with diabetes, back pain or chronic illness. Lolland is amongst the top three in every category. Lolland Town Commune is notorious for having a host of social problems and is home to almost half of the patients who are treated in Nykøbing Falster Hospital. The staff at the hospital are understandably disgruntled by the state of affairs. When asked to provide examples of things they can take pride in, a member of the administration board referred to the following 6 points. A fine new building that was recently opened to the public. A well-functioning casualty department. The fact that they are well-placed in several areas, in the so-called clinical quality databases. The children's ward is praised by its patients. Recently, PhD students have come to the hospital, and finally, young doctors and medical students from the University of Copenhagen generally submit good evaluations from their time at the hospital. The 1,400 employees of the hospital can take pride in the fact that their workplace on the outskirts of Nykøbing Falster is often hailed as a cornerstone of the local community. There are 150,000 people in the region for whom Nykøbing Falster is the place to go should they fall ill. And if the hospital were not located where it is, with a capacity of 270 beds, patients would have a long way to go to find an alternative institution. In fact, apart from Nykøbing Falster Hospital, no other healthcare institution is available to residents of Region Sealand. But irrespective of how hard service care providers work for their patients every single day, it seems as if only the negative stories about Nykøbing Falster Hospital are remembered. The hospital is often singled out as the institution with the highest mortality rate in Denmark. It ranked second in the Danish tabloid newspaper BT's list of Denmark's life-threatening hospitals. 2 years later, another tabloid newspaper, Ekstra Blod, dubbed Nykøbing Falster Hospital the worst hospital in Denmark. And there are other stories. For example, the report from 2016 revealing that, due to the high incidence of serious errors in the region, the internal and abdominal surgical department of the hospital would no longer perform operations. Nothing to boast about. This report had the hospital's director trotted out before the media to issue an official press release to assure the public that it was safe to be treated at Nykøbing Falster. It was not the first time a public statement of this kind was deemed necessary by the hospital's administration, and every time the reputation of the hospital was dealt another wincing blow. It is a challenge to recruit staff. There is the nursing school on the other side of town, of course, which draws potential nursing staff to the area, and every year it provides a new class of qualified nurses from the immediate community. The task is even harder when it comes to doctors. Before they can join the Danish job market as qualified physicians, young doctors must complete a term on a rotary system, and Nykøbing Falster Hospital is one of the least popular places to work in Region Sealand. Once they have completed their obligatory service, few doctors look to the Southern Hospital as a potential place of employment. For this reason, and to meet the demands of its surgical schedule, Nykøbing Falster Hospital is often reliant on temporary internships or foreign doctors. This factor is highlighted in the 2016 report on the high incidence of errors that had occurred in the hospital's surgical department. The fact that Nykøbing Falster Hospital offers the fewest areas of specialisation in comparison to other hospitals in the region does not help to attract prospective doctors either. The team of medical professionals on the wards is reminded of this fact every time they are obliged to transfer a patient to another hospital as soon as the patient's condition involves a complication that requires specialist knowledge and care unless the condition is related to the heart, because one of the country's high-profile heart surgeons is currently employed at the hospital. His name is Pierre Grander. Nykøbing Falster Hospital succeeded in winning the heart surgeon for their team, as well as several other prominent names from Rigshospitalet, the state hospital located in Copenhagen. At the time, the appointment of these specialists was a success story for Region Sealand, but the backstory includes another narrative, wherein the relevant cardiac surgeons only considered the transfer to the south after they had been fired by the state hospital, which had reported them to the police in connection with the theft and mismanagement of research funds. Subsequently, Pierre Grande was convicted on the charge of spending more than 2 million Danish kroner on, amongst other things, private travel, Rolex watches and restaurant meals, money which was actually earmarked for medical research. In recent years, Nykøbing Falster Hospital has launched several campaigns to attract prospective doctors. One with the slogan "Arrive at work asleep" offered regular bus transportation which would shuttle them back and forth between Nykøbing Falster and Copenhagen for a mere 50 kroner. In addition, a staff hotel had been organised for those who dare to stay over for a few nights. The hospital administration even found the money to keep the canteen open in the evenings. But despite the fact that job announcements repeatedly refer to a view over the stunning nature of Guldborgsund, despite the efforts of the campaign website comsouth.dk to tempt prospective staff with a particular demographic foundation that provides patients with several diagnoses and complex conditions that are not common in other places in the land. Despite the declaration that the hospital plays a particularly important role for the citizens of this corner of the country because the distance to other treatment facilities is very far, despite all these efforts, Nykøbing Falster Hospital is still struggling to recruit qualified staff. These challenges still existed when the young nurse Christina Eistrup Hansen was appointed in 2009. She had worked on M130 during her studies, and before long her boss promised Christina a position would be waiting for her the day she could present her final certificate. As such, she received her first qualified nurse's appointment at Nykøbing Falster Hospital the summer she completed her training, at the age of 24. Nykøbing Falster Hospital was vastly different to the other places Christina had done her practical training. The lack of sufficient staff was apparent everywhere, including on the M130 ward, but this meant she was soon given more responsibility than might ordinarily be required of a newly qualified nurse. Christina moved to Nykøbing specifically for work. She had studied at Herlu Nursing School, and during her student training, she worked at Herlu Hospital, just north of Greater Copenhagen. In comparison, Nykøbing Falster Hospital seemed incredibly small, and not just because it only took about 12 minutes to walk all the way around the entire hospital complex. Christina had to get used to the idea that her new place of work was so small that everyone appeared to know everyone else. Herlu Hospital was at that time the tallest business complex in the country. As a rule, when you took the elevator to a different department, you were bound to share it with faces you hadn't seen before. This never happened in the elevators at Nykøbing Falster Hospital. It did not take long for Christina to settle into the work on the ward, which she loved, and she soon found a group of good friends on M130. She was appreciated for her nursing skills by her supervising staff nurse as well as the doctors, who took note of the new nurse with the dark hair. She soon had a reputation at the hospital for being ambitious and very committed to her work. But Christina was also known as a controversial person. After she had been with the team on M130 for about 2 years, she started to attract a great deal of attention that was not entirely positive. Several nurses on the ward disliked her. Some of them no longer wanted to work with her. She made them feel uncomfortable, they told their supervisor. There was something about her that they simply could not fathom. When Christina had been working on M130 for just over 3 years, she decided to make a fresh start. She took the stairs down to the A&E department and applied for a position with them instead. And it was here that she found the job she had always longed for, a place where she could excel at her work, and excel at the work she did. Again, she was praised for her skills. Again, she earned the admiration of the doctors, who were pleased to work with a new nurse. until it all went horribly wrong. Newcombing Foster Hospital's Accident and Emergency Department is situated on the ground floor of the hospital complex. It is an elongated building whose sliding doors open onto the bay, where the Falck ambulance staff wheel in the new patients on stretchers. The department has been called the country's longest casualty corridor. Its spine is a long linoleum-floored hallway with wide doors on either side. Walking from one end to the other, you pass through three casualty wards, acute 1, acute 2, and acute 3. They are not separated by doors, and the patients' rooms are clustered along the broad passage with fluorescent lights running along the ceiling above. Approximately 100 employees work on these wards, with its constant activity of white coats, beds, and equipment. Coming through the doors, acute 1 is the first ward you encounter. Here, new patients are received, fingers are stitched, broken legs are put in casts, and wounds are cleaned. Acute 1 houses the emergency room. Matte glass sliding doors open onto the ambulance bay, where people with urgent and more serious cases are brought in on gurneys, traffic accidents, cardiac arrests, blood clots, lung disorders, and all those patients who have conditions and illnesses that require the immediate attention of a medical professional. Upon arrival in acute 1, new patients are allocated a colour code in the hospital's system, depending on the relative severity of their condition. This is the primary task of a nurse who is specifically trained to make a spot judgment of the incoming person's condition. The patient is code red if their situation is life-threatening and therefore requires the immediate attendance of a doctor. Code orange is less critical, code yellow is less urgent, code green is only marginally urgent. Once the colour code has been noted in the new patient's medical chart, they are wheeled to their allocated room in acute 2 or 3, unless their situation is so critical that they must be treated in the emergency room immediately. Acute 2 and acute 3 have 16 beds available in each ward. Throughout a typical day, the porters can deliver between 50 and 80 new patients. This system functions on the ground rule that a patient is admitted to casualty for a relatively brief period before they are transferred to one of the other departments in the hospital. The maximum period of stay on the casualty wards is 48 hours. Once this time frame has passed, the patient must either be sent further into the system or discharged. This is the golden rule. As such, you should only work on a casualty ward if you are comfortable with the fact that you will constantly be met with new faces. It is this constant turnover of people which attracts a particular group of nurses and doctors to the hospital's busiest ward, which they call a one-way street. Patients are never transferred to casualty. The stream comes from the ambulances and flows through the casualty corridor to departments in other wings of the hospital. On the casualty wards, the tempo is high. It is crucial that the staff can stabilise the patient's condition as soon as possible. Their job is often analogous to a detective's. The essence of the tasks performed by the doctors and nurses in acute 2 and acute 3 consists of figuring out what is wrong with the patient they have in front of them. Chief Physician Nils Lundin loves doing rounds in the rooms and cracking what he likes to call the critical diagnosis. He is one of those doctors who has reconciled himself to the idea that a casualty physician is perhaps not the most prestigious title you can aspire to, but Nils has never had a burning desire to work in the more prestigious departments of a hospital. Instead, he is attracted to what happens in the A&E department, where the ambulances literally arrive at your door, and it is the detective work that he appreciates most. The adrenaline rush. In A&E, situations can quickly spin out of control, requiring you to think on your feet and prove that you can, in fact, play the instrument called professionalism. He is aware that others might think it morbid, but Nils considers himself lucky to have a job where he spends most of his time with patients who are seriously ill, i.e. patients who are colour-coded red or orange. Nils feels as if he can make a difference when the condition of the patients is critical. The same applied to a high incidence of cardiac arrest alarms. He does not mind if the cardiac arrest alarms sound on his watch. Nils was 41 years old in 2009 when he joined the permanent staff of Nykøbing Falster Hospital, At first, he was the hospital's only member of staff that specialised in emergency medicine. Nils immediately felt at home on the casualty corridor. He had never been the kind of doctor who found satisfaction in burying his nose in a textbook or having lengthy theoretical discussions about tropical diseases, for instance, and as a student doctor, he only became passionate about medicine once his training became practical. Nils had worked as a practicing physician in Copenhagen for a few years before he took an internship at the hospital, and once he had obtained a permanent role in A&E, he realised that emergency medicine was his actual calling. It was here that the work of a doctor was practical and hands-on, less talk and more action. And he felt successful in his profession, especially since when he started out, you could not specialise in emergency medicine as a particular field of interest, and his fixed appointment to the A&E department soon allowed him to gain the expertise to become an accomplished practitioner in his chosen field. A speciality other doctors only experienced when they were called down to the ground floor from the other branches in the hospital. Nils Lundin studied medicine at the University of Copenhagen, but the rota system in Denmark brought him to Nykøbing Falster in the southern provinces of Denmark. After he completed his obligatory term of service, he started a family and decided to remain in the region. His first relationship in Nykøbing Falster did not last, but after he was appointed to the A&E department on a permanent basis, he met Pernilla. At first, it was a little awkward. Nils thought that Pernilla was a newly appointed nurse, when in fact she was a student, completing her practical training, as he later discovered. And there was a substantial age gap between the two of them, more than 20 years. When they first started dating, they did not make their relationship known to their colleagues at the hospital, but they decided to stay together in the long run. Pernilla was mad about the chief physician, who, despite his grey hairs, could be rather childlike, as she said with a laugh, if her girlfriends asked what she saw in the older man. And ultimately, Pernilla and Nils didn't care what folk thought. They made it official and bought a large house just outside the town of Maribo on Lolland, in amongst the meadows that stretch across the landscape. Their home had plenty of space for guests to stay over, and rooms for the children they shared. Pernilla had a child from a previous relationship, which was the reason she'd moved to Lolland from Odense. Nils had a child from his first relationship, and soon Nils and Pernilla had a son of their own. With a newly established family on Lolland, Nils and Pernilla's future promised to be a bright one, and soon Pernilla received a permanent appointment at the hospital as well, the day after she obtained her official qualification as a nurse. One of the first things that Nils noticed about Christina Eistrup Hansen when she started working in the casualty department was her looks. The long hair that she had dyed pitch black, always a thick layer of mascara to match, a well-rounded figure with curves that you couldn't help noticing, and she was bright. She made a competent impression on the chief physician, and she seemed to settle into the team of other nurses with ease. Christina was very committed to her work. She always pitched up 15 to 30 minutes before her shift began, and when her shift was over, it was not unusual for the nurse to ring her colleagues to ask how things had turned out with a particular patient on the ward. It was obvious that the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.